try not to talk too fast because I have a whole lot that I want to throw at you and a whole lot that I want to play and not a whole lot of time to do it. So if I start to talk too fast, people in the front yard, just raise your hand. So if you don't know, I teach piano here, and like a lot of people, my first instrument was piano. Probably not like most people. The reason I started playing piano was I had a childhood crush on Kevin Costner. So when I was like 5 or 6, a friend of mine invited me to her sister's piano recital, and characteristically I was like, well, I don't really know what a piano is, I definitely don't know what a recital is, but I'm in, I'm game, let's do it. So we went to this recital, and the kids are playing up front, and I was like, man, this is so boring. But I was looking at what they were doing, and I've always been the kind of person that loves to learn how to do things. And so it looked like what they were doing was cool, it just didn't sound very cool. And then the last performance, the capstone piece, hopefully you'll recognize it. You can like raise your hand if you recognize it. But this little girl got up and played this. Prefaced it with, I want to play that song. So then, when I was 6 or 7, this movie came out. I hear someone say Jurassic Park. Okay, so why did my parents let a 6 or 7-year-old watch that movie? No idea. I had nightmares for ages. But I begged for the movie for Christmas. Everyone got the memo not to give me this movie, except for my third cousin, like 3 or 4 times removed or whatever. So I open it on Christmas Day, and my mom makes that noise that she makes when she disapproves, but she's not going to say no. And a couple of days later, we're watching the movie, and I'm doing what I do when I watch movies, which is not watch movies. I'm coloring and playing with my toys and whatever. And then the last scene of the movie, the survivors are flying away from the island in a helicopter, and the main character looks out the window, and there's this pelican flying. And that theme starts, at which point I was like, and watching the television. And I would watch from that scene to the end of the credits and rewind it and watch it again and rewind it and watch it again and rewind and watch again. Some days I got the movie out and fast-forwarded just to the end and would watch the end credits because I was obsessed with the music and didn't know what a soundtrack was. So my poor parents had to watch that over and over again. And I think probably around that point that's when they decided, okay, let's give this kid some music lessons. So I started taking piano, and my dad was in the Coast Guard, so my musical training was kind of a hodgepodge of things. One place we lived, I took at a conservatory, because that's all there was. And then I think the very next place we lived, my dad asked every man on base about piano lessons, and someone came up with, this guy's wife took piano through 7th grade, maybe she can help you. And so that's where I took from. So eventually we moved to Virginia, and that's where my dad retired, and I started taking piano with some people who had some formal musical training, and I started doing some competitions and festivals, and I did pretty well. I always got comments like, very expressive, beautiful playing, right next to exceptionally poor technique. So kind of a mixed bag of things. So my family started asking me when I was in high school if that's what I wanted to go to college to do, if I wanted to study piano, and I was like, no, definitely not. piano is like my solace, my refuge. This is what I do for me. I don't want to go have to do it for someone else. That's not my thing. And everyone's like, yeah, okay. So junior year, I ended up in AP Music Theory, and the band director discovered I could play piano and convinced me to play vibraphone in indoor drumline. So vibraphone is like this much of this instrument, and it has, and it's made out of aluminum, and it has a pedal that functions exactly like a piano pedal. So the guy had all these percussionists that didn't know what to do with this pedal, so he asked me to come do indoor drumline, and I did that and discovered that playing music with other people is really cool. And from there I did band and orchestra, and one of the first things I remember playing in band was like an arrangement of the theme from Superman, which you don't, if you don't know, is the same composer that composed Jurassic Park. So automatically that's like kind of the beginning and the end of the percussion story. I was like, oh, I'm playing the music by this guy and this is awesome. So around that time, because of, you know, the John Williams connection, and then also because my band directors really inspired me, I decided that maybe I wanted to be a band director. And the only school, or the school that I really wanted to go to, you couldn't be a piano major and an instrumental music education major. You had to be choral, and if you played piano. So I was like, okay, well, I've been playing baritone and marching band for 4 months, and I've been playing percussion for like 9 months. I'll audition on percussion. And I was and I was waitlisted at first, but then one person dropped over the summer, so I got to start on time anyway. And very soon after I started, I realized that public school was really not going to be my happy place. And so I tried some other music majors, and then decided I'd be happier in a lab studying people. I was going to switch majors to biology or something. And my professors were like, no, 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 please don't do that. Please stay here. And they convinced me to be a performance major. And they were like, all you have to do is hit stuff all day. And I was like, ah, yeah, that sounds good. I really like hitting things. And, you know, and I had kind of gotten sucked into the whole musical world. I had been introduced to this instrument. I had fought many battles with this one. I had gotten to start playing this instrument over here, marimba, and I loved them all. Today I wanted to show you everything about everything, but I don't have enough time to do that. So I just brought two of my very favorite ones, and then one that I chose to bring simply because of tradition and portability, because this is kind of my nemesis right here. This is a snare drum. It has these snares on this very thin head on the bottom, and they make this slappy, rattly sound. unlike instruments like violin or piano or anything like that, the history of the performance practice and even where this drum came from is not really written down, or it wasn't for a very long time. drummers were part of very secretive guilds, and everything got passed down through stories and by rote, and so we just don't have that available to us. There's a lot of debate about where this instrument actually comes from. I'm of the camp that thinks that it is a descendant from an instrument that was brought back from the Middle East with the Crusaders to medieval Europe. And they had the Islamic military forces had an instrument kind of like this. It was a bit bigger that they hit on one side with a mallet and on the other side with a reed or a split stick. So it made that slappy, rattly sound. So that's my defense for my argument here. So as far as the music goes, we only sort of know what it sounds like, but we do have remnants of what made up the music in the form of rudiments. So with a pitched instrument, you have scales and chords and modes and stuff to organize the music. On snare drum, you have these things called rudiments, and they were passed down phonetically. Is phonetically the right word? How they sounded? So there's like the mummy daddy roll. The paradiddle, and there were flams and drags, and when you put all these things together, you get a rudimental solo. So I'm going to play one for you. Disclaimer, not a rudimental snare drum player. But I really wanted you to hear what one of these solos would have sounded like, and the one that I'm going to play for you is one of the oldest ones that we have that was written down. It was written down in 1790. It's a traditional snare drum solo, and it's called The Downfall of Paris. I'm going to play it without the snares because my little sissy snares can't handle the rudiments, so you wouldn't actually be able to hear them very well. So I'm going to play it without the snares in this case. All right. So, Downfall of Paris. Published 12 etudes for solo snare drum, and it kind of revolutionized the way we thought about the snare drum. He had dynamics and accents and musical phrasing and musical expression, and took this instrument that was very technical and very primitive and made it into something artistic, and gave, you know, drummers an opportunity to be musicians and not just battery, you know. So there's still going to be some rudiments, but they're not the structure of the piece anymore. They're just ornaments on what else is going on. So this is going to be etude number one. And then other people decided that they wanted to use other kinds of sounds to make snare drum solos. So you can also use different places on the head to get a different sound and create the different effects. And then you can also hit the drum in different places, like on the rim or on the lug or on the shell. And then we're also using different things to hit it with. So drumsticks, brushes. This is a timpani mallet. So the next piece I'm going to play it's sparse on rhythmic ideas and thematic material, but it does use all these different sounds in each section to create something interesting and musical. So this is called A Minute of Muse. And there were going to be four different voices that could play together in a band. So this one is the tenor pan or the lead pan. It's made from the very top of the oil drum. It's not very deep with its skirt here. This is the skirt. And this guy would play the melody in a band and take the place of a violin, like in an orchestra. The next voice down has two drums, and it's a little bit deeper, and it would take the place of the viola. And then the next voice after that is actually called the cello voice, and it uses about that much of the drum, and there's usually three of them, and then the bass voice, and there's six of those, and it uses the full size of the drum. So the traditional, or one of the traditional musical genres in Trinidad that would be used for steel pan is called soca, and in that, this voice plays the melody, and then the double voice, the double drums, double seconds, would play some kind of strumming pattern. We call it a strumming pattern that would go something like... And then the cellos would play some other thing that interlocked with that melody. Song for you, but it's hard to make it sound interesting when you don't have all those other voices. So you guys are going to get to use your voices to sing with me. Who's done Everybody Loves a Saturday Night with me before? Okay, all right, we've got some veterans of this song. So you guys are going to learn the words right now. Here's how they go. Here's line one, repeat after me. Everybody loves a Saturday night.
Everybody loves a Saturday night.
Excellent. Don't forget to enunciate. Line two. Everybody loves a Saturday night.
Everybody loves a Saturday night.
You guys are so good. All right. The third line requires a little bit of mathematics. Everybody, 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 everybody.
Everybody, 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 everybody.
Excellent. Full marks. The fourth line. Fourth line, you might recognize, everybody loves a Saturday night.
Everybody loves a Saturday night.
Beautiful. Okay, so I'm going to play the melody through once so you can kind of hear how it sounds. And then I'm going to hopefully remember to count you in. And everybody's going to sing. And you're going to sing very loud. And it doesn't matter if it's in time or in tune or even if you remember the words. Just sing. Okay? All right, here we go. It's used for popular music, classic rock, people use it in jazz, Latin music, classical music. So it's very versatile and can be used pretty much anywhere you would like to use it. So the next two pieces I'm going to play, hopefully they're going to be well because the composer is in the room. The first one is The Maze, and to me it's more of an art music song. It's based on the compositional idea of a minor third, which is that sound. You'll hear that kind of throughout the piece. And then the second one I chose because it has that more Latin feel. Yes, so The Maze is first. as you ask the question in your head, let me answer it. Yes, it is different from a xylophone. A xylophone is like this much. It's tuned differently from this instrument just a little bit. And the tradition that it came from in the U.S. is different. So the xylophone is more of a European folk instrument that found its way into the orchestra and came to the U.S. via the orchestral tradition. The marimba came to the U.S. from Guatemala with the Hurtado Brothers Marimba Band that did a tour of the U.S. at the turn of the 20th century. And so this is a souped-up version of a Guatemalan marimba. The bars are made out of rosewood, just like a Guatemalan instrument would be. But instead of wooden resonators, these are brass resonators. The resonator makes the sound last longer. So if I cover the resonator, it kind of sounds like that. And with the resonator, it sounds longer and prettier. The resonators on this instrument are tunable, so I can make the sound, if the sound sounds a little weird, I can make it longer. I was going to demonstrate that, but it's complicated. I can show you afterwards if you really want to see. the unfortunate thing about this particular brand of instrument, this beautiful brand of instrument, is that these bars at the end are wider, but they're also a whole lot thinner. So I bought this secondhand from a high school. It's taught 20 years of high school students how to play marimba, which is really cool, but it does have a cracked bar on it that you'll maybe hear. So this is like a regular bar, and then there's a little tick in there. So that means that somewhere inside there, the bar is a little bit cracked. So if I hit it, don't, because I know that it's there, it's fine. The first piece I'm going to play is kind of an homage to Guatemalan marimba. It's called Wood That Sings. So the legend in Guatemala, when they cut down the tree to make the rosewood bars, when you go out into the world and play the rosewood instrument, it's the tree that is now the bars crying or singing for her lover who's back in the forest. So kind of sad, but also kind of beautiful. Gordon Stout was a former teacher of mine, and he plays a lot of guitar music on marimba. A lot of people play a lot of guitar music on marimba because it translates very well. It sounds very pretty. Usually, there's a melody like that one, and then there's an illusion of a sustained chord going on with a repeated note like that. Gordon kind of took that idea, but flipped it. So the repeated note is actually a long melody note, and the moving notes at the beginning are going to be the chords, just so you have, you know, something to listen to other than Wood crying for her lover. So this is what it sings. Thank you.
Thank you.
for you. I think it's probably going to end up going just a little bit over time. Sorry about that. So this piece, in its full form, is about 20 minutes long. So I've cut it down, don't worry. I had to leave an interesting part of it out, though, and I just want to play just a little bit of that part for you because it's really cool. This piece, unlike the other two pieces I played for this instrument, were written by an actual composer. So he writes for symphonies and bands and everything, and not like a percussion composer. And it's really important that we have people that don't play this instrument writing for us, because it forces us to do things that we wouldn't think were possible on our instrument, which is both good and bad sometimes. So I haven't talked about this at all, which is silly, but percussion instruments only have attack usually, right? And then we have a little bit of reverb and then the sound is gone. Unlike someone who sings or blows air through their horn or draws a string across it or whatever. And so we use rolls to kind of create an illusion of a sustained sound. And so this piece has a section that has rolls in it with a counter melody in the other hand. So you have to do the roll with one hand and do other stuff over here. So here's a little bit from that section. Explanation. It's very programmatic, and the piece is